Yes, students, we are going to start next chapter here, which is the laws of motion. And this is, of course, the first lecture on that. And we will continue in the coming classes. Basically, the few topics they have now written for recapitulation because you have studied these topics in your lower classes. But we have to go in all the detail because if you are not knowing about these things, then you will not be able to work out for the further topics. So you need to take care. You should be knowing the force, which is the first physical quantity coming to you in this chapter. So of course, very important physical quantity it is. And you are defining it like push or pull also at times. But if you go with the definition of force, of course, it's an external agency which is changing or tends to change either its state of rest or motion, or it changes its direction of motion or its shape. So when you are applying some external force on a body, you can change, bring the changes. These three type of changes can be brought by applying the force. So we have to go in more detail of this force only in this chapter. For that, the various studies were done, and first of all, the Aristotle, he did the study, and he said that an external force is always required to keep a body in motion. So that was proved wrong by Galileo as well as Newton. Why? Because they had a reason behind them. And the reason was because Galileo did many experiments. He did many experiments, like he said that if I remove the air resistance and we make the paper and feather to fall from a greater height, then they both reach at the same time. And he did this study by taking inclined plane. With the inclined plane, if a ball is released from here, then it rises the another inclined plane. In the absence of friction, the ideal condition of this, then only it will rise to the same level. But because in nature, what is there? Friction is always present. Air resistance is always there. And that was the reason that Aristotle was not able to give you the correct conclusion. But Galileo did the experiment after removing the friction. In the absence of friction, he did all the experiments. And then he studied that if there is no friction, then it means the body in motion can be kept in motion without applying any external force. This was after doing a series of experiments, like he did. If inclination is kept same, then the ball in the presence of friction will never rise to the same height. But if I'm changing the inclination, the ball is able to move for a longer distance. So, if I remove the friction, then the body in motion kept moving. It was observed by him, just like you can make the ball to move over the ice slab. So, the different thing conditions can be checked to simply to remove the friction. He said that in nature, friction is present. And that is why Aristotle was not able to give the correct conclusion. And he proved that it was whatever study was done by Aristotle, the conclusion was not correct. Whatever study was done by Galileo, he said that if there is no external force, it means if the net external force is zero, a body which is at rest always remains at rest. And a body which is in uniform motion, it continues to move with that particular uniform velocity with which it is moving. And he said this property of the body, due to which it remains at the condition of rest or it remains in the condition of motion, is termed as inertia. So he introduced a new term with you, that is inertia with you. Inertia means resistance to change. So Galileo gave you the law of inertia, that it means the body is not changing its state of rest or uniform motion unless an external force compels to change its state. So if no external force, then the body at rest will remain at rest, or the body in uniform motion will remain in uniform motion. This is what he said. And by the study of Galileo only Newton gave the first law. And first law is again the same whatever was given by Galileo as the law of inertia. And that is why we are calling Newton's first law as the law of inertia also. And I am reading it out for you, bache. You all are aware of this law that everybody continues to be in state of rest or of uniform motion in a straight line until and unless it is compelled by an external force to change its state of rest or of uniform motion. It means if a body is at rest, it will remain at rest. If a body is in motion, it will remain in motion until and unless some external force is applied. You can come up with the definition of inertia. It is the property of the body due to which it resists the change in its state of rest or of motion, uniform motion of case. And that is why this first law is termed as law of inertia, because if the question is coming that why Newton's first law is termed as law of inertia, because the same thing is said by the definition of inertia, it is the property, and that property is being used in stating the first law, and that is why we can call Newton's first law as the law of inertia. So that should be clear to you. Of course, if you want to understand inertia, then you should be knowing inertia of rest, means the body at rest tries to remain at rest, and for that there are various examples, like if you are sitting in a bus and a bus driver comes and starts it suddenly, then you get a jerk in the backward direction because you want to remain at rest. If you are talking about inertia of motion, it means if you are in the moving state and all of a sudden brakes are applied, then you fall in the forward direction again because of inertia of motion. And similarly, inertia of direction, if you are making a stone to move in a horizontal circle and if you just stop it, it always goes along the tangent. As we have studied, that velocity at any point along the circular motion is along the tangent. So it wants to continue in the same direction in which it was already. So of course, you can be asked with various questions which can be answered by the knowledge of inertia of rest, inertia of motion, inertia of direction. That should be clear to you. And of course, if a body is heavy, then it is having more resistance to force or to the change of state. I can say if you are having a heavy truck, then you can't move it with your finger, but a ball you can move. So more the mass, more is the inertia. That means we can say that inertia is the can be measured in terms of the mass of a body, or I can say mass is a measure of the inertia of the body. That also should be kept in your mind, because on this also you can come with the application questions, because recapitulation is all there in your syllabus. So you should be knowing about what is inertia and how inertia is going to change by applying the force. So if I'm having a stone of size of football, it has more inertia, of course, than the football, because football is made up of rubber and stone is heavy than that. So you have to see whose weight is more. Clear? So similarly, cricket ball has more inertia than the rubber ball of the same size. So that you should be knowing, even if the size is same, but you have to see the mass. Whose mass is more? Mass, of course, is the quantity of matter. The next quantity, physical quantity with you, is momentum. Momentum is, of course, a vector quantity which depends upon mass and velocity of the body. You can define it, momentum is the measure of quantity of motion of a body. It means momentum is a measure of quantity of motion in the body. It means it depends upon mass and velocity. You can write it as the product of mass and velocity, but of course velocity is a vector quantity. So linear momentum we are talking about. Linear momentum is also a vector quantity. It means we are talking about motion in plane or motion along a straight line. So linear momentum, it is a vector quantity. And of course unit will be kilogram meter per second. For mass, it will be kilogram meter per second, you can write. and of course the dimensional formula is years m lt minus 1. So this is about the linear momentum. Now if I have this formula, then various graphs can be plotted, because you should be having the idea of graphs. If I am having the mass of the body is constant, then linear momentum is directly proportional to the velocity. It means you can say that if you plot a graph between the linear momentum and velocity, it comes out to be a straight line with a slope. And similarly, if you are keeping the velocity of a given body constant for the different bodies of the masses, then again if you do the graph plotting between the linear momentum and mass, it comes out to be a straight line with a slope. But if you say that there are two bodies whose linear momentums are equal, then you can see that velocity is inversely proportional to mass. And then if you do the graph plotting between m and v, you are getting the graph like this. Of course, various conceptions can be formed on this concept of the linear momentum. They may ask you, they may give you a lighter body or a heavy body. Then if velocity is same, then of course you can see linear momentum of the heavier body will be more than the lighter body. And same way you can get the questions on all these three cases, and you can conclude on the basis of the basic formula, which says that linear momentum, it is equals to mass into velocity. So you have to keep this formula in mind, and all these three cases you should be able to apply in various conceptual questions. On the basis of the knowledge of the linear momentum, you can write the Newton's second law of motion, that says that the rate of change of linear momentum is of a body is directly proportional to the applied force, and it always acts in the direction in which the force is acting. So this P is a symbol for linear momentum. So force is directly proportional to change in linear momentum to the change in time. If I remove the proportionality constant, I get a constant K, which is the constant of proportionality. And I can write this change in P with respect to time in terms of the derivative also, dP by dt. And in that case, this can be mass can be taken out, because P it is equals to m into v. So mass is most for a given body is always constant, can be taken out. Then this can be written as dv by dt, and change in velocity with time is nothing but acceleration, you all know. So I can write f equals to km a, and of course force is a vector quantity because acceleration is a vector quantity. Now if I say that force is one unit, mass is also unity, acceleration is also unity, then we can prove that k constant can be considered as one. And the law which is coming to me in the another form, that is F equals to ma. Force, it is equals to mass into acceleration, and the direction of the force will be same as that of acceleration. So force is a vector quantity. And of course, I can define one Newton also from here, which is the unit of the force given by the name of the scientist Newton only. So that also you should keep it in your mind. So these are the points which you should have in your mind, that of course force is a vector quantity. It can cause acceleration or deacceleration depending upon you are applying the force, or you are applying the brakes, whatever way you are applying the force it means. And SI unit is Newton, and one Newton can be defined as the force which is acting on a mass of 1 kilogram and producing an acceleration of 1 meter per second square. So 1 Newton is 1 kilogram meter per second square, and the dimensional formula is mLt minus 2. So whatever quantity you may cross, you are able to write its units as well as the dimensional formula. And if you want to write it in vector form, you should be able to write the components of the force. That means if I am moving along the x direction, then fx can be written as dpx by dt, or I can write it as max. Similarly, fy, can be written as dpy by dt, which is equals to may, and fz also can be written as equals to maz. So in the component form also you should be able to write any vector quantity is coming across you. That also you should be having that knowledge with you. So of course most of the time, like we will be using in the lab also about the force, then force years I can have the absolute units as well as the gravitational units. Absolute units, which I have just discussed, that is in the absolute terms, which is used, SI unit is 1 Newton, which is equals to 1 kilogram meter per second square, and in CGS it is 1 dyne, which is equals to 1 gram centimeter per second square. And if you want to put the value of kilogram into gram, you want to convert that 1 Newton, it comes out to be equals to 10 raised to the power 5 dyne. But if I talk about the gravitational units of force, gravitational units means when we are working on the earth, then I can write it as 1 kilogram weight, or I can say 1 kilogram force, which is equals to m into g, that is the weight of the body, that is given by simply multiplying it with 9.8 in terms of Newton, if I want to write, because in the laboratory, whenever we use the masses, then force we use the gravitational units of force. And in day-to-day life, on your practical, for your means on the SI system or in the absolute terms, whenever we are talking about, we talk in Newton or in dynes. And in gravitational unit, in CGS system, it is equals to 1 gram weight or 1 gram force, I can say, which is equals to 980 dynes. So these values you should be knowing about the gravitational units and the absolute units of force, because we will be asking you, and different questions you should be aware of. If they give you the question in gram weight or kilogram weight, you should be able to convert it into Newton or dyne. That should be known to you. So the force, next quantity with you is impulse. That is actually when you are throwing a ball, you are bringing the change for a means you are applying the force, I can say, for a very short interval of time. Like when you are throwing the ball on the wall, it touches it and then it comes back. So it is, the force is being applied on the wall for a very short interval of time. And at that time, that force into the time is giving you a new quantity, which is known as impulse. So impulse is simply the product of force and time. Time, which is bringing, of course, the change in the linear momentum, and this product we are calling it as the impulse. So impulse can be written as force multiplied the time duration. And we will be proving it that this impulse, it is equals to change in momentum. And that will be simply your impulse momentum theorem. And the because the units and yours will be the same as that of your momentum. So again, here it will be your kilogram meter per second. Kilogram meter per second, or you can write it in Newton. You can write it in Newton second also. So dimensional formula is same as that of the linear momentum. And because momentum is a vector quantity, so impulse is also a vector quantity. So if I am applying the large force, which is acting for a short interval of time, that large force I call it as the impulsive force. So this thing, the definition of impulse should be clear to you. It means I'm applying the force for a very small or a very short interval of time. This, if you want to write it in vector form, then J is the symbol for the impulse and it is equals to F into T. So force is a vector quantity, so you can say impulse is also a vector quantity. So you should be having this knowledge about the impulse, how to define it and to write its unit as well as its dimensional formula. So if you want to take the help of the knowledge of calculus method, then if you are applying the force for a very small interval of time, I can write the small amount of impulse that is given by f dt. And for the total impulse j, it can be written as integral of dj for the time t1 to t2. If you are applying, then you can write it as the average force which is remaining constant into t2 minus t1 upper limit minus lower limit. And you know integration of dt is t. Integral of dt is t, f is taken out. That f we are calling it as the average force for the given interval of time. Then I can write that impulse that is equals to average force in the given interval of time multiplied with that small interval of time delta t, which is equals to t2 minus t1. It means the time when you start to the time when you stop. And on the same basis, you can prove the impulse momentum theorem. Impulse momentum theorem again is important for you for your examination purpose, which states that the impulse, it is equals to change in linear momentum. So statement also should be known to you. And if you have to prove it, of course we are taking the help of Newton's second law of motion, which states that the force is directly proportional to the rate of change of linear momentum. So f, it is equals to dp by dt. Of course small p is the symbol for the linear momentum. So if I cross multiply, I will be getting f dt, it is equals to dp. And if you simply want to take with the magnitude, so you can write with the modulus sign also if required at time. And here if I'm saying that the time is changing from 0 to t, at that time, it means initial, when the time is 0, let the linear momentum is p1. When the time is t, linear momentum is p2. Then change, because here I am having dp. So I have to consider, assume the limits for the linear momentum. As you all are aware of the calculus method, we are talking about the definite integrals. So when the time is changing from 0 to t, let the momentum changes from p1 to p2. You can write it in words. And here, if I take the integral, integral of dt is t and f delta t, it is nothing but the impulse. So on the left hand side, f delta t will give me the impulse. And on the right hand side, if I take integral of dp is p and the limits are p1 to p2. So upper limit minus lower limit, that is p2 minus p1. So I can write impulse, it is equals to change in linear momentum. And it is the statement of the impulse momentum theorem also. So you can prove the impulse momentum theorem, state and prove is the direct question. But of course you can get other questions also, conceptual questions, numerical problems on the basis of this. So you all should be aware of impulse as well as the momentum. Linear momentum, of course, I mean. And if here you talk about the force applied is the constant force or the variable force. So in both the cases, you can take the help of the graph. If you have to find the impulse, on that also many questions can be framed, that they give you the value of the force. Either they can give you in the form of graph or they can give you in the form of component. They can give you in different forms. So this is just to understand, if they are giving you in the form of graph, then area under the force time graph gives you impulse. So for the constant force, it is quite easy. You have to simply draw the perpendiculars on the time axis. You have to take the area covered under the FT graph. If here this is T1, this is T2, I suppose, then I have to simply take the area under the FT graph. And here if the force is variable, then what you have to do is, you have to take the very small intervals, like for the small intervals of time you will be checking, then you are not going to get the particular thing about it. For this, so if it is a shape, rectangle or triangle, you can take it comfortably. But if there is no particular shape, even if you take for the very small intervals of time, then for that case you will be always taking the help of integration. It means you will be taking integral 0 to t 1, then t 1 to t 2, then t 2 to t 3, and so on, and you will be adding up all the things, or in means as a whole I can write it as impulse it is given by integral of f dt in the given interval of time. But in the question you can always divide the things and you can work out with the things. Now, what is the importance of the impulse in day-to-day life? On that you can get the conceptual problems, like when an athlete is jumping, is provided with a cushion or a heap of sand to fall upon, because if it the person is falling on the concrete or on this marble, then you will be getting the less time of impact and you will be hurted more. But if some cushion or some sand is there, then you have to have the, you are increasing the time, so effect of force will be reduced. So you can keep the formula in mind that for this F1 T1 it is equals to F2 T2. So for that, if you are keeping this formula in mind, F1 T1 it is equals to F2 T2, then you can work out with the various questions on the basis of that. So you are increasing the time, so you are reducing the effect of force. Similarly, you can be asked with the questions like, why buffers are provided in between the various bogies of the train? That also can be asked. So variety of questions can be asked. Like one more example I have written for you, like for packing materials, you use the thermocol or bubbled plastic sheet or paper strands for packing the glassware for the transportation purpose, because these materials, they help to increase the time. And when they are increasing the time, so effect of force will get reduced. So as a result, the articles, they are not broken. So different examples of this can be asked on the basis of that. Basically, you have to keep this thing in mind that your impulse or the momentum, change in momentum has to be the constant. And then you can work out with the things. You can answer those questions. It's up to this.